yield reduction 41 to 49%, and the preserved ejection fraction, this normal, this is a little bit strange. Preserved ejection fraction with heart failure, when ejection fraction is more than 50%. Long time before, when I see the report of echo, I first look for ejection fraction. If it is more than 50%, so this patient is okay, forget everything. Actually, it's wrong, because as we will see, the patient may have some damage or some non-structural damage of the myocardium, so that's why it may cause heart failure. Why this will happen? Like patient with chronic diseases, hypertension, COPD, chronic kidney disease, obesity, anemia, or depression, all this may lead to some changes, like impaired feeling and relaxation, atrial dysfunction, dynamic mitral regurgitation, vascular dysfunctions, and pulmonary hypertension. All these issues precipitate heart failure in patients with normal heart structure. And of course, if we have more risk factor of that, the patient will be higher possibility to develop heart failure. Now we have what is named the cardiac complication after major non-cardiac surgery. And these depend on four factors: pre-operative factors, intraoperative surgery and anesthesia, and post-operative changes. As you know, surgery and anesthesia is associated with CNS system, sympathetic nervous system stimulation, hypercoagulability, bleeding. The more tissue damage, the more the inflammatory response, and patient may be hemodynamic instability, hypoxemia, hypothermia, in addition to the reduced oxygen saturation, pain, and something is important as well, the withdrawal of the cardiovascular drugs. Some patient may stop it, and they don't know they should continue it until the day, the morning day of the surgery, or maybe the patient with emergency surgery is not able to take his oral medication. Anyway, all these changes lead to the oxygen supply demand mismatch, and this is the most important cause of ischemia infarction in the perioperative period. Coronary artery thrombosis may happen, but it is less common than the oxygen supply demand mismatch. At the end, we have myocardial ischemia, myocardial infarctions, and the patient may have congestive heart failure and even cardiac arrest. So all these changes, as you can see, it can be modified or manipulated by the anesthesiologist to minimize the incidence of myocardial injury. So how we know the patient with heart failure? How is this feel? We have four stages of heart failure. The first stage, the patient at risk. There is no actual damage of the myocardium yet, like hypertension, diabetes, obesity, and the patient has, somebody's doing a change in the slide or what? Treatment of hypertension, this is the treatment or management. Treatment of hypertension, diabetes, dyslipidemia. So this is the first stage. Any problem? I think everybody is
just a few minutes. I'm sorry.
And stage B, there is structural heart disease, and the patient has no signs and symptoms of heart failure yet. So the patient may have previous MI, patient reduced ejection fraction, valve disease, but again, there is no signs or symptoms. At this stage, we have to add the EC inhibitors or angiotensin steroid receptors blocker in all patients. Aspirin can be given, beta blocker in some patient, and statin can be added as well. Stage C, the patient at this stage has already signs and symptoms of heart failure and a decreased exercise tolerance. Then we add another more medication like aldosterone antagonist, diuretic, digoxin. Patient may need pacemaker or even ICD if the ejection fraction is less than 30%. Stage D, this is the most severe form, and the patient may need continuous inotropic support, or even he needs heart transplant or long-term hospitalization. It is not safe to discharge the patient outside the hospital. So this is the four stages of heart failure. And from the medications and from the preoperative assessment, you can know the severity of heart failure. Again, for come to the European guidelines, they added two important medications for the treatment of heart failure. The first one, the dapagliflozin, and this is sodium glucose co-transport 2 inhibitors and usually used in diabetes mellitus type 2. And it is indicated in patients with reduced ejection fraction. So it should be added. As you can see, the grade of recommendations 1. So it should be added in all patients with reduced ejection fraction. Versigat, this is added in patients with NEHA class 2, class 2, class 4, with worsening heart failure despite the conventional treatment. And this medication works by enhancing GMB pathway. So these two new drugs added to the treatment, chronic treatment of heart failure. And you may ask how an anti-diabetic medication may improve heart failure. The answer is here. For the sodium glucose transport inhibitors, they increase the sodium and glucose excretion. So it decreases the load on the kidney. That's why we have some improvement in the ventricular functions by this effect. Also, it increases the hematocrit by increasing the erythropoietin production from the fibroblast. So in short, increase the sodium glucose excretion and improve the ventricular functions. And it can be used in non-diabetic patients as well. When they use it first in diabetic patient and they observed that there is improvement in the heart failure, they tried to use it in the non-diabetic patient and they found also reduction in the cardiovascular death and reduce in the heart failure hospitalization. And also it improves the metabolic parameters in non-diabetic and including the body weight and the blood pressure. Regarding the Versigat, which is used in patients not responding for conventional therapy, there is some endothelial dysfunctions and GMB deficiency, vascular dysfunction, myocardial dysfunctions. This is in patients with heart failure. When we are giving Versigat, it enhances the sensitivity to nitric oxide, so it increases the GMB. So the end result, reduce the left ventricular hypertrophy, increase vasodilatation, and increase the renal blood flow. So we can understand now why Versigat and the anti-diabetic medication is added to the anti-failure therapy. Beta blocker is an important drug for the left ventricular systolic dysfunctions, and it is recommended in all stable patients and also can be used in heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. Contraindication, acute decompensation, of course, EV block and bronchial asthma. Another important intervention in patients with heart failure is the use of the pacemaker and the three indications in ejection fraction less than 35%. Before it was recommended in ejection fraction less than 30%, now less than 35%. QRS duration more than 150 and left bundle branch block. Now we will come to another point, the heart failure as preoperative risk factors. As you know, Goldman established his risk index in 1977, maybe 40 years now or more, and he put heart failure in top of all the other risk factors. So they recognized the importance of heart failure as a perioperative risk factor since long time. Also, Lee index, he put the history of congestive heart failure in top of the risk factor, including high risk surgery, ischemic heart disease, stroke or transient ischemic attack, diabetic patient, and the patient with renal dysfunctions. And here is the contraindication of elective surgery, of course, acute and recent MI, unstable angina or coronary syndrome, decompensated heart failure, patient with significant arrhythmia, severe valvular disease. If the patient has heart failure, either stabilized or not stabilized, and coming for non-cardiac surgery, we expecting higher morbidity and higher mortality. In this study, they review more than 200 million surgical patients. They found that about 4.9% has diagnosed already as a heart failure. And the mortality is higher in patients with acute heart failure, not acute and chronic, or even chronic compensated. And we will have some explanation for this. Patient with new heart failure is a higher mortality than acute and chronic, acute on top of chronic heart failure. Now we have the myocardial injury in non-cardiac surgery patient, and we have two groups, patient no myocardial injury and the patient with myocardial injury. With myocardial injury, higher rate of the cardiac arrest, 0.8 here, 0.06 only. Heart failure occurs in 9.4 here in 1% only. And the patient who has myocardial injury, the mortality is high, 1 from 10 patients. So we should avoid this heart injury and to diagnose it early. If you are query about any patient with ischemia or infarction or heart failure, troponin should be measured to know if the patient has myocardial injury or not. Another problem, heart failure increases the incidence of postoperative acute kidney injury, especially if the surgery is associated with bleeding, ventilation, the effect of anesthesia, and hypovolemia, all may predispose to acute kidney injury. Another challenge, it is maybe difficult to diagnose the postoperative heart failure. The patient is sleepy, taking analgesic, or maybe the patient has been for any reason. So it is the presentation is atypical than in non-surgical patients. Another study published 4 days ago about the death after surgery among patients with chronic disease, of course, including the heart failure. But this study in UK only. They studied more than 100 million patients. Age is between 36 to 68, and they didn't include the obstetric surgery. About 80% coming for elective and about 20% coming for emergency surgery. And 26.8 from these 8 million has chronic disease. And the primary outcome from this study, 90 days death after the surgery. Mortality was 4.7 in patient with chronic disease and 0.4 only in patient without disease. So if the patient coming with chronic disease, the mortality is 10-fold more than the patient without cardiac, without disease in general, whatever cardiac or non-cardiac. So what is the most common chronic disease which may cause mortality? They found about 4 causes, 7.7 of all patients, but causing 60% of the deaths. Dementia, 17.9. Heart failure is about 12.6, and cancer 12.1, and liver disease 10.3%. So any patient coming for surgery, whatever elective or emergency, and they have one or more of these 4 chronic problems, we can talk with the patient or his family, they have higher morbidity or higher mortality according to the clinical situation. Perioperative anesthesia concern, of course, we need to improve the recovery before surgery. The common term now, enhanced recovery after surgery. But usually I like the term before surgery. That means you are doing your best to optimize the patient before putting him under anesthesia and surgery. Patient with heart failure, of course, should be evaluated, optimized by the cardiology. The medication, some medication may hold it, but in general, we have to continue all the anti-failure therapy. Any medical problem should be optimized, especially anemia. Discussion with patient, his, her family, according to the risk for surgery. And even simple intervention improves the outcome. Patient has improving his exercise tolerance, improves the malnutrition, weight reduction, treatment of chronic pain and the patient education. For example, the preoperative exercise, this is suggested 30 minutes five times per week. Something is very simple. If the patient is doing simple exercise like walking or simple running 30 minutes five times per week, increased respiratory muscle strength, decreased dyspnea, improves the endothelial functions, improvement in the fiber composition of the muscles, decrease insulin resistance, decrease the inflammatory process, decrease the renin, angiotensin, and aldosterone, improve the economic balance of the heart, especially in diabetic patients, increase cardiac output, decrease the feeling pressure, decrease resting heart. Again, something is very simple, but it have multiple systemic effect and can improve the outcome. Regarding the anemia, the international recommendations to keep hemoglobin more than 130. And any patient coming with expected intraoperative blood loss more than 500 and he has any signs of anemia, he should be investigated and treated before coming to the elective surgery. Another preoperative optimization, all the patient should have echo and BNP. And if there is new diagnosis of heart failure and there is initiation of the anti-failure therapy, it should be 3 months before coming to the elective surgery to improve the left ventricular functions. And again, BNP has independent prognostic and diagnostic regarding the severity of the heart failure. In general, this is the preoperative assessment, BNP, 12-lead ECG, echo, X-ray, and blood count, renal functions, thyroid functions, fasting glucose, and HB1. This to see the patient has chronic hyperglycemia or no, and transferrin saturation. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and the 5, this is or should be essential in all patients with heart failure. I know this is a lot of discussion about which medication to stop and which medication to continue. I will summarize it here very quick. Regarding the ACE inhibitor or angiotensin receptor, the blockers should be continued in all patients with heart failure and left ventricular systolic dysfunction. That means reduced ejection fraction. If the patient is not in this group of the drug, should be initiated at least 1 week before the surgery and to follow up the patient. Transient disconnection or discontinuation before non-cardiac surgery in hypertensive patient. Actually, this depends on patient by patient. There is many case record of severe bradycardia, severe hypotension, and even cardiac arrest in patient on ECE inhibitors or ARB. So if the patient at high risk of the hypotension or bradycardia, just hold one dose, the morning dose, then continue it after the surgery. Regarding the beta blocker, you should continue in all patients. If it is indicated for any reason, for example, more than 2 clinical cardiac risk factor should be initiated, and at least as I like the ACE inhibitors, 1 week before the surgery, and the best medication, atenolol and bisoprolol. So this is in short to summarize the anti-failure therapy, when to continue, when to stop. Now we will come, what is the factors which may precipitate heart failure? This is in medical patient, not in surgical patient, but we can apply all the principles or most of the principles in our surgical patient. You can see moderate to severe anemia is this is the most common cause causing heart failure in 63% of the patient. Myocardial ischemia, improper diet may be high salt or high fat diet, valvular dysfunctions, infection, adding negative inotropic medications. That's why we need 1 week at least before the surgery, arrhythmia, and uncontrolled diabetes, 12%, uncontrolled hypertension, 11%, and we have another factors. Anyway, that's why we told improving recovery before surgery medical optimization of chronic medical disease, including anemia, before coming to surgery. Now, the effect of anemia and myocardial injury and the non-cardiac surgery, this is a recent study published in June 2021. They classified anemia or hemoglobin according to the from 11 to 13. It is mild anemia. Point important here, they considered hemoglobin less than 11 is moderate anemia. Of course, less than 10 or 9 will be severe anemia. Incidence of myocardial injury is double. Here 14.5, here 28.6. That's why there is stress, more stress in treatment of the anemia before coming to elective surgery in all patients, not in heart failure patient only. We should understand the relation between oxygen delivery and oxygen consumption in patients with heart failure. Here we have the normal persons, the hemoglobin 13 to 15, and if hemoglobin dropped to 6 or to 7, we will have critical oxygen delivery. That means the patient will start to have anaerobic metabolism. If the patient has heart failure, there is shift to the right, and the critical oxygen delivery may occur at 8 or 9. If heart failure plus anemia, it may occur at 9 or even at 10. That's why anemia plus heart failure is very risky. If the patient has heart failure, anemia, and multi-organ dysfunctions like in sepsis, for example, it may occur more than them. So this is the, and this is not my talk. I can see the reference is here in annuals of intensive care. Anyway, heart anemia is still a risk factor of heart failure, even in patient, non-cardiac patient or patient non-heart failure. There is another important function for RBCs beyond oxygen transport as well. That's why, again and again, we have to treat and to improve the anemia. RBCs is important in the hemostasis because the tight junction between platelet and RBCs to form the thrombosis depends on the bulk and the volume of RBCs. Of course, if the patient is anemic or hemodiluted, the thrombosis or the hemostasis will be impaired. RBCs is important in thrombin generation, platelet activation, and the activations of the coagulation factor 8 and 9. And as you know, hemoglobin is important to buffer. The buffering system of the plasma depends on the bicarbonate, plasma protein, and the hemoglobin. This is the three main factors. So if you missed the hemoglobin and the patient will be buffering power is less. Another problem from the anemia is the vasoplegia because hemoglobin is the primary oxygen sensor and the modulator of nitric oxide. It is needed for the activation and the deactivation of the nitric oxide. So if you have, for example, hypotensive patient and he's anemic in the same time, and you are trying to treat the hypotension by vasoactive medication, there is poor response because of the anemia and because of the vasoplegia. Another problem which may precipitate myocardial injury and heart failure is the pain. You can see here the possibility of myocardial injury regarding the pain score. The higher the pain score, the higher the possibility of the myocardial injury, and sure, you should diagnose it with troponin. And in conclusion, there is high pain score within 72 hours after surgery, significantly associated with myocardial injury. Hypotension, of course, we are aware enough about the hypotension, and if there is drop in blood pressure more than 50 millimeter mercury, there is 60% absolute increase in the risk of the perioperative myocardial infarction, and the myocardial infarctions may cause heart failure and cardiac death. Now we have patient with heart failure for urgent non-cardiac surgery, either this compensated or decompensated. Is the patient we has coronary acute coronary syndrome or no, this is you should decide it before. the patient in heart failure. Is this heart failure due to the already decompensated heart failure he has, or there is new acute coronary syndrome? If acute coronary syndrome, should be referred for the cardiology and take the acute coronary syndrome pathway. So you will assess the heart failure, either it is stable or new onset or decompensated or refractory. If it is stable, this means the patient may have got functional capacity, you can go and proceed for surgery. If it is stabilized, you can go to the surgery. If unstable, you can continue the heart failure therapy. If patient is not responding to the anti-failure therapy, and that means he has poor functional capacity, we should weigh the risk and the benefit of surgery, if possible, non-surgical management. If not possible, the patient can go with very high risk for morbidity and mortality. So in general, this is the management of patient either stable or decompensated or refractory heart failure. If you have intraoperative heart failure for any reasons, we have three categories. Either systolic function, this means low cardiac output with congestion, diastolic dysfunction, the patient may be hypertensive but still has congestion and the volume overload. For systolic dysfunction, dobutamine or milrinone plus or minus norepi. And if the patient is hypertensive, of course you need to use vasodilator like natoprusside or nitroglycerin. And volume overload, simply you will use loop diuretics to improve your patient. So this is the main three types of heart failure. You may see it during surgery. Recently, they introduced the term of hyperdiuresis. When you are using hypertonic saline plus intravenous Lasix, this will improve the diuresis, because most of the patient of heart failure may have hypochloremia, and this causes sodium retention. So if you give hypertonic saline, you will reduce the hypochloremia. And the recent randomized control systemic review of 11 randomized controlled trials, acute decompensated heart failure, when they use hyperdiuresis, this hypertonic saline plus furosemide, lower all-cause mortality, increase the diuresis, higher urine output and sodium excretion, shorter hospital stay, and reduction in the heart failure readmission, but these recommendations is low to moderate. Now we have interactive case discussions. Patient, 64 years old man, he's hypertensive, diabetic type 2, dyslipidemia, a little bit obese, and hemoglobin is borderline in mild anemia. He's already in enalapril, oral hypoglycemic, metformin and glibazide and atorvastatin. And this patient has severe osteoarthritis and coming for bilateral total knee replacement, and anesthesia was done under combined spinal epidural anesthesia and the propofol sedation. And of course, because of hypotension, we use the phenylephrine to maintain MAB more than 65 or 70, surgery for around 4 hours, blood loss is 400 ml, and received 1.5 liter of Ringer lactate, but no intraoperative blood transfusion. Is this patient at risk for perioperative heart failure? He has many of factors that we are mentioned in the start of the lectures. That's hypertension, diabetes, dyslipidemia, obesity, and anemia. So in recovery room, he is fully awake, alert, no being in epidural infusion, oropivacaine 0.1 plus fentanyl 2 mic per ml, 6 ml per hour, and he was stabilized on that. But actually, after 35 minutes, he has shortness of breath, dyspnea, a little bit hypotensive, tachycardia, saturation decreased on nasal cannula 4 liter, and the blood loss from both drains is 550. When the blood gases was done, a little bit acidotic, PO2 91, CO2 32, bicarb is 19, lactate 3.4, base axis minus 4, and hemoglobin 8.1. ECG diffuse ST segment depression and multiple BVCs. We checked for cardiac enzymes. It was high, and the BNP is high as well. So there is some sort of myocardial injury and heart failure. Actually, this patient has myocardial ischemia and functional heart failure and the pulmonary edema from the acute anemia and the hypovolemia. We infused the two back the RBCs very quick, but no vasoactive medication were given. And he was stabilized after 3 hours and the cardiology follow up for 72 hours without any more cardiac event. Another patient, he developed heart failure as well, 27 years old, lady, 58 kilo, presented with ER, lower abdominal pain for 3 days. In ER, she is drowsy, pale, hypotensive, tachycardic, and the saturation 96 on room air. Abdominal ultrasound was done, and there is fluid in the peritoneal cavity and in the pelvis. And she gave history of missed of 2 periods for 2 months. So the diagnosis is rupture ectopic for urgent laparotomy. Is this patient at risk for heart failure? You can see there is no risk factor, may only be some anemia. But see what will happen. She came to OR with 2 units of RBCs, and there is no arterial line, just we did venous blood gases, and BO2 is 72, CO2 43. Remember, it is venous, not arterial. pH 7.1, bicarb is 15, base excess minus 9, and the hemoglobin is 7.9 only. When the surgeons open the abdomen, there is around 1 liter, 200 ml. That's why we infused 1 liter of Ringer lactate very quick, and 2 units of RBCs over 20 minutes or 30 minutes. But unfortunately, after a few minutes, the patient desaturated and increased airway pressure, fluorescent pink excretions coming from the intracranial tube, chest is bubbling, and very congested neck veins. So the picture is clear. The patient has overloaded or maybe has heart failure and pulmonary edema. What is the reason for that? Is 1 liter of Ringer lactate unit of RBCs with blood loss more than 1 liter causing overload? Of course, no. So what happened? Actually, the patient received 2 liter of normal saline in ER, but unfortunately, it is not endorsed to the anesthesiologist in operating room and not documented in the patient file either by the ER doctor or ER nurse. So iatrogenic fluids overload, pulmonary edema, it happens from the anesthesiologist, but from before, from ER doctor who give 2 liter, which is not recommended, not recorded. Anyway, we come to the last third of the lecture. The patient with apparently normal heart and may develop perioperative heart failure. That means the patient don't have hypertension, coronary artery disease, valvular or congenital heart disease. But despite of that, he may develop heart failure. We understand about the cardiomyopathy, dilated, hypertrophic, restrictive, and arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. But actually, we are not talking about these cardiomyopathies. There is another categories, which because all of this, you can understand this patient already in heart failure or compensated heart failure. So you will take all the precautions and understand the risk well. But who is the patient? You may miss him. As we mentioned, in at some stage, patient who developed acute heart failure without background of cardiac problem, the mortality is high. Why this will happen, we will see. We have a lot of types of cardiomyopathies. It depends on the chronic health problem. Diabetes, obesity, liver cirrhosis, uremia from renal failure, chemotherapy, or alcohol abuse. All this causing some changes in the heart and causing heart failure. Here, the heart is absolutely normal, but there is an acute medical issue causing the heart failure, like septic cardiomyopathy, peripartum, and stress cardiomyopathy, neurogenic stent myocardium, which occurs with severe subarachnoid hemorrhage, stroke, traumatic brain injury, or even patient coming for electroconvulsive therapy at risk. It is very minimal, not of course, it is not high, but we should put it in our mind. Some patients may have negative pressure pulmonary edema and may be the most common cause after anesthesia, improper reversal of the muscle relaxant, and the patient is struggling to take a deep pressure, deep inspiration, so he may develop negative pressure pulmonary edema and may occur in thoracic surgery. So neurogenic stand myocardium for any patient with acute CNS injury, as we mentioned, severe TBI or subarachnoid hemorrhage, there is sympathetic nervous system activation, systemic vasoconstriction, pulmonary vasoconstriction, a lot of inflammatory mediators from the passing from the blood-brain barrier. So the end result, pulmonary capillary pressures increase the permeability and causing pulmonary edema and increase left atrial pressures and left ventricular pressure as well. Septic cardiomyopathy, again, sepsis is a systemic disease and causing a lot of changes, especially the effect on the myocardium and the endovascular system, and may cause mitochondrial dysfunction as well, abnormality in calcium handling, oxidative stress, adrenergic pathway downregulation, these downregulation of the adrenergic receptors and the poor response for the adrenaline or noradrenaline. So the end result, we have left ventricular hypokinesia, and 50% of the patient may have ejection fraction less than 40 or 45% without any previous history of cardiac disease. Again, because of the septic problems and left ventricular hypokinesia. And the recent recommendations for the management of this type of patient, to start with NOR-AB as a first line with target MAP 65 and consider adding vasopressin if there is no response for NOR-AB. And if the patient has cardiac dysfunctions, you may need to add dobutamine or switch to epinephrine. And you can use all these vasoactive medication in the peripheral veins with more diluted concentration and for short times, maybe a few hours until you establish the central venous access. Peripartum cardiomyopathy, it is non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, and it is very common to find the ejection fraction less than 45%. And the problem that the heart failure symptoms can be confused with the common symptoms of normal pregnancy. That's why we should have some red flags. If the patient has dyspnea at rest or exertion, or tachypneic, decreased oxygen saturation, chest pain, or orthopnea, syncope, dyspnea with tachycardia, all these maybe should alarm us. It is not a normal pregnancy symptoms or signs. It is maybe due to the peripartum cardiomyopathy. And they found that severe left ventricular systolic dysfunctions with ejection fraction less than 36% in 67% of the patients who have peripartum cardiomyopathy. And another interesting point, 67, about two-thirds of the patients occur postpartum, not during the pregnancy. And 6 months outcome, including thromboembolic, 7%. That's why most of the patients, they put him after delivery on anticoagulant, rehospitalization 10%, and the mortality 6%. Unfortunately, the recovery from the peripartum cardiomyopathy in Middle East and Africa is very low, 37% only in Africa, 25% in Middle East. If you compare with Europe or Asia and Pacific, 57% recovery, 62% recovery. And the management of peripartum cardiomyopathy, it is the same like the patient with heart failure, except we are not using ECE inhibitors or angiotensin receptor blockers or aldosterone receptor antagonist in the patient with pregnancy. But otherwise, the management is almost the same. After delivery, we can use the same medication and anticoagulation, especially if the ejection fraction is less than 35%. And some patients may need cardioversion, implantable cardio defibrillator or the pacemaker. So in general, this the have to remember you about the red flags in this with in symptoms or signs, which may be like the normal pregnancy. Patient with preeclampsia or severe preeclampsia may progress to the concentric hypertrophy and myocardial and diastolic dysfunctions as well. So late onset preeclampsia or severe preeclampsia is another risk factor of heart failure. And they found that the ultrasound or echo abnormality in patients with severe preeclampsia, 33% of the patient has diastolic dysfunction, 19% increased left ventricular end-diastolic pressure, again, some sort of heart failure, and 10% may have systolic dysfunctions. So late onset preeclampsia or severe preeclampsia should have echo to evaluate the cardiac functions. Diabetic cardiomyopathy, another perioperative risk of cardiovascular morbidity and mortality, and increase the fold of mortality by 2 to 3 times. And it occurs in 1/4 of the patient with type 1 diabetes and 1/3 of the patient with type 2 diabetes. That means it is more common in the non-insulin dependent diabetic patient. And the manifestation is usually resting tachycardia, exercise intolerance, hypotension, perioperative cardiovascular instability, silent ischemia and infarction, or even sudden death. When I expect the patient, if it is only 1/3 or 1/4, patient with chronic hyperglycemia or poorly controlled blood sugar, higher incidence of cardiovascular autonomic neuropathy. The neuropathy occurs in 50% in patients with cardiomyopathy. Nephropathy, this can be diagnosed by albuminuria and autonomic dysfunctions, or even, of course, the patient has signs or symptoms of heart failure. Actually, it depends on the duration of the diabetes. Early, we have parasympathetic denervation and increase the sympathetic tone, so the patient may have resting tachycardia, but with the time and denervation of the sympathetic system as well, impaired exercise tolerance and orthostatic hypotension. Obesity, we have the same problem also. The obesity, hypoventilation syndrome, hypoxemia, acidosis, pulmonary arterial hypertension, and right ventricular hypertrophy. This leads to the right ventricular failure. And left ventricular failure may happen also in obese patients due to the increased circulating blood volume, increased cardiac output, and left ventricular hypertrophy, the end result, left ventricular diastolic systolic dysfunctions. And if the patient developed left heart failure, he may develop right heart failure, or the reverse may happen as well. The lipotoxic heart disease, 10% of persons of BMI more than 40 has signs and symptoms of obesity, cardiomyopathy. That's why they suggest the patient with more high BMI or long-standing obesity to have preoperative cardiac evaluation, of course, including echo. Serrated cardiomyopathy in patient with chronic liver disease, we have three types: reduced cardiac functions, compensatory phase cardiac failure. In reduced cardiac functions, it is just a hyperdynamic state. But here there is tachycardia and the palpitation as well. In cardiac failure, of course, hypotension and the pulmonary edema. ECG here, just QT prolongation, but we have multiple PVCs. We may have bundle branch block and this myocardial ischemia in the third stage. Echo, just isovolemic relaxation time, diastolic dysfunctions, here systolic dysfunctions and hypokinesia because of the cardiac failure. So patient with chronic liver disease, of course, he need good cardiac assessment. Chemotherapy and radiation, you can see most of the medication used in the chemotherapy causing cardiomyocyte damage and heart failure. Some may cause hypertension, may cause ischemic vascular effect and coronary disease. Radiation may cause valvular disease, pericardial disease, and also coronary ischemia. And some medication may cause thromboembolism and arrhythmia. In short, most of the drug subgroups used in chemotherapy may cause cardiomyocyte damage and heart failure. The third case, This is the last case. 37 years old female patient in anxiety, depression, and BMI, mild obesity, is 32, and she's a smoker as well. Admitted day before the surgery with acute cholecystitis for laparoscopic cholecystectomy. So she's in the hospital for about 24 hours or more. And when she came to OR, she is very anxious. And in the waiting area before she is going to the operating room, she had chest pain and palpitation. She is hypertensive, tachycardic. That's why we did ECG. We find diffuse ST, T waves, it changes. So what do you think, what happened to this patient? Okay, yeah. Seen by cardiology and after assessment of the cardiac enzymes and echo was done as well, it is diagnosed as tachotaspo or stress cardiomyopathy. And this is because she didn't take, why she came very anxious. She was in the PO for about 2 days. She didn't receive her medications for anxiety, depression. And that's why she developed the stress cardiomyopathy. And it is more common in female patients as well. And fortunately, she is recovered very quick because it is mild degree, not so severe. And we did the surgery after 5 days without a problem. So we will come to the last type of tachotaspo cardiomyopathy, which occurs due to the emotional or physical stress and the effect in the hypothalamus and the release of the catecholamines. And at the same time, the predisposing factor, as we mentioned, 6 female patient, postmenopause, schizophrenia, anxiety, depression, as we mentioned, diabetic patient or chronic medication, all these may cause stress cardiomyopathy. And according to the Mayo Clinic, we have diagnostic criteria. The echo showed left ventricular hypokinesia, dyskinesia, or akinesia, and regional wall motion abnormality beyond the single coronary artery. This means global hypokinesia, not only effect on the left ventricle or right ventricle, only absence of obstructive coronary artery disease by angio, and the new ECG changes ST elevation or T wave inversion and no acute brain injury or fibromocytoma because the high catecholamines may happen with acute brain injury, subarachnoid hemorrhage, intercerebral hemorrhage, and may cause the same problem. For assessment, the perioperative tachotaspo cardiomyopathy, they found that 93% of the patient, 84 of them are female, GA in 67, it can occur with neuroaxial regional anesthesia 14%, even with sedation 5%, not reported in 14% patient. Not all the patients develop heart failure, but it can occur in 57% of the patient. That's why some patients may recover very quick and the complications which may happen arrhythmia, stroke, and even cardiac arrest. At which stage of anesthesia? It can occur during induction, either early or middle, or even during the emergence during from the surgery, this early or middle of the surgery. Postoperative, some patients may occur still postoperative, day zero, the same day of operation, day 1, day 2, or even after the 3 days. Anyway, stress cardiomyopathy can occur at any stage, pre, intra, or postoperative, according to the stress on the patient, emotional or physical stress. Here are some of the factors which may trigger the cardiomyopathy: inadequate depth of anesthesia during intubation, extubation, oxygenous use of catecholamine, anaphylaxis, and electroconvulsive therapy, excessive CO2 absorption, use of ergotamine, cardiac arrest, spinal cord stimulation during replacement or removal of spinal cord stimulation. Again, this is maybe not common. Most of them are, or all of them, case report. So just they collected the triggers which may happen during anesthesia. So now at the end of this surgery, you have to forget everything, but please remember these 6 slides. The classification of the heart failure either reduced or mildly reduced or preserved according to the ejection fraction. This is the stages of heart failure and the medication used in each stage. And we can use dabigluflazine as well, and the Varsigat can be added for some group of patients. Preoperative assessment, as you know, PNB, ECG, and echo, chest X-ray, electrolytes, renal functions, and blood glucose, thyroid functions as well. And here, the factors which can be manipulated and modified by the anesthesiologist to minimize the incidence of myocardial injury or the myocardial infarctions. And some patient with normally or apparently normal heart may develop heart failure. And the last thing, treatment of the heart failure according to systolic dysfunctions, diastolic dysfunctions, or volume overload. And thank you very much for your attention. And I am very sorry for this long time.
Shukran lakum, Dr. Yasser, a very impressive lecture. Thank you, really. We start by 75 attendants and we leave and we are 75. No one leave the lecture, even for a while. Thank you, Dr. Yasser.
Thank you so much. So, what is the? I need to write the question, please. If somebody need a question to write it, you can see all.
Okay.
No questions here. محاضرة ممتازة دكتور ياسر. شكرا دكتورة صفاء لهذا التجمع العظيم.
I told at the start I am your student from the start.
دكتور خالد احنا 75 وانتهينا 75 يعني ودي يعني very good sign.
يعني very good start. شايف كتير من طلبة الدكتوراه اللي داخلين الامتحانات موجودين.
مع الدكتور ياسر.
ربنا يوفقهم جميعا.
ان شاء الله يا دكتور خالد.
الكلية والمعهد الكبد انا شايف برضه ربنا يوفق الجميع. It's a very good opportunity ان احنا كلنا نتعلم ون educate ourselves بصراحة.
صراحة دكتور خالد كمان الدكتور ياسر بصراحة بيعمل المحاضرة بتاعت الهارت فيلير دي حاجة يعني بصراحة ما فيش بعدها حد المفروض يذاكر تاني هو هيحفظ الكلام ده
دكتور خالد your comment in patient chronic liver disease and the cardiomyopathy you have more experience than us in this situation
طبعا evaluation of patients with end stage liver disease وطبعا انا معايا وشايف في الاتندنس هنا في اميره وفي ايه اميره الخولي وايه علي they always help us to prepare patients with end stage liver disease for liver transplant surgery. طبعاً cardiomyopathy is a major problem which we face with cirrhotic patients. طبعاً احنا بنتأكد من الكلام ده باستخدام الإيكوكارديوغرافي وبنوصل لدرجة احنا بنعمل stress ECG as well. ونشوف الكانديديت بتاعنا is acceptable, ejection fraction بتاعنا برضو في الإيكو is acceptable because we can face certain difficult situations during liver transplant, for example, particularly during the reperfusion phase. وطبعا احنا عارفين ان في ناس كتير وبالذات في السنتر بتاع القصر العيني بيستخدموا transesophageal echocardiography during surgery. We are using in Menoufia the transesophageal Doppler to measure it non-invasively. We measure the cardiac output. I think we are the only center in Egypt that's using the transesophageal Doppler. And even in the Middle East, we've been using it widely. It's not been used yet in Saudi Arabia here, but it is coming this month to be introduced. Transesophageal Doppler, and then many equipments, maybe three or four machines. Most of the residents are using it. We're actually using it also to guide the fluid management, because if you don't guide the fluid management during a surgery, a long surgery or a surgery like liver transplant, you might, as Dr. Yasser explained, you might over transfuse your patient and increase the CVP, and then this might lead to congestive heart failure. We are actually not using the CVP to guide our fluid management. We're using the corrected flow time of the transesophageal Doppler. And we are also using non-invasive electric cardiometry, stroke volume variation. Here in Saudi Arabia, they are using, and in Asyut also, they are using the pulse pressure variation. And I know that you're using also pulse pressure variation, Dr. Yasser, in your Sheikh Khalifa Hospital. And I think it's important to guide hemodynamics and fluid during these critical stages of surgery.
Dr. Khaled, regarding the hemodynamic, personally, I don't have a good experience in the transesophageal and maybe we didn't work with it, but the other monitor, this for minimally invasive, there is a lot in the market at the moment it is used. Maybe there is the monitoring depends on the risk of surgery and the risk of patients. Very simply, if it is very simple procedures in low risk patient, basic monitoring. High risk patient or high risk surgery, at least stroke volume variation by any way, by the transesophageal probe or by the high risk patient plus the high risk surgery, it should be completely invasive procedures. You have to measure the cardiac output, peripheral vascular resistance. This is the simple 3 point for the monitor.
Yes, yes.
Okay, yeah.
Dr. Yasser, really it is very nice lectures and it is informative lectures. Dr. Khaled B, أهلاً وسهلاً بحضرتك دكتورة صفاء. Very يعني touchable effort had been done for this group, and I like this group because she encourages the juniors, and she is doing a very nice job for the juniors, and I appreciate her effort really, and all of this collection of the seniors and the juniors. Dr. Safa, thank you so much for this group, and I hope for all the people in every government in the Egypt to do like this symbol. Dr. Yasser, thank you for this lecture. And I'd like us to ask one question that I had heard since long time about the heart failure. Is there any place for using the beta blocker preoperatively for heart failure to upgrading or upregulating for the receptors for this heart failure? Is this applicable nowadays? We can use beta blockers for preparation of the patient for heart failure?
Regarding the beta blockers, there is a lot of change since it is introduced to the patient with heart failure. The current recommendation, as I mentioned it, in according to the European Society of the Cardiology, all the patient with heart failure should have, especially stage two, should have beta blockers and should be initiated in very low doses, then increase gradually according to the patient response. Before, it was contraindicated in patient with heart failure stable. But if the patient developed already heart failure, it should discontinue it until stabilizing him. But if the patient is already stabilized heart failure and compensated heart failure, he should have beta blocker. And as we mentioned, the best choice is atenolol. Start atenolol in small doses and increase gradually until obtaining the desired effect. And I should focus on that. It is the cardiology job, not our job. We are not following the patient for a week. We're following the patient for a few hours post-operative. And if you see him the second day, it will be a good issue. So it is the cardiology job. But at least we can understand why this patient came in this medication and why this patient is not in this medication. For example, we Dr. Nahla asking about who is writing the antihypertensive medication internationally. Actually, all of us refer the patient, even uncontrolled hypertension, to the internal medicine or to the cardiology. Even now, there is increased the responsibility of the anesthesiologist as perioperative physician. But again, if you are following the patient and all your time you are staying in the clinic, you can do that. But usually you are in the clinic for a few days or one day, then you will go for the operating room after that. So the ideal way refer to the internal medicine and the cardiology, because this is his job to optimize and to control the patient, either for surgical or non-surgical patient. Okay, Dr. Nahla?
Dr. Safa, I hope I hope from these people who are attending, and they are our colleagues. I hope from them to be interacting with us. Yeah, I hope not to be such a delivering a lecture, but this group, I think from your idea, you did the preparation for the people, for the exam, for the oral exam, for interaction. So please, let us interact with the people and the people to interact with us. For example, if we ask questions, like we are in a physical lecture, not to delivering a lecture and to know the feedback from the attendees.
If it is possible. فكرة جيدة جدا دكتور عصام وأنا بأيد رأي حضرتك ورأي دكتور محمد الشافعي previously who said that maybe every time we should have one of our junior staff to present a lecture under the supervision of one of the professors, because it will then help them to interact with us. But it is very good, really.
دكتور
exactly,
دكتور صفاء في سؤال عن septic shock and heart failure patient, how we can manage the fluid in this situation. Actually, if the patient with septic shock without heart failure, the current recommendation to give 30 ml per kg as initial fluid resuscitation to stabilize the patient. But if the patient has heart failure for any reason, usually the septic patient has both absolute and relative hypovolemia. So he needs some fluids, all right? So you can start, for example, 10 ml per kg, and in the same time, to start vasopressors, whatever, noradrenaline or adrenaline or dobutamine, according to your assessment and situation. So if the patient is hypotensive, the initial management gives 30 ml per kg. Then if not responding, give norepi. Now you will start the both in the same time. You will give the fluid bolus and you will start the vasopressor in the same time. And you will titrate it according to the response. Correct?
حلوة السؤال ده جميل جدا بتاع السبسز سبسز and how to manage sepsis. دي actually رسالة الدكتوراه بتاعت دكتورة غادة محمود, هي موجودة معانا برضو في الجروب هنا غادة. هي بتستخدم برضو ال corrected flow time in transesophageal doppler to monitor the septic patients and give both hemodynamic and fluid guided management, which is very good work. I think she will present her thesis very soon inshallah. بالتوفيق دكتورة غادة.
ان شاء الله.
أوكي. شكرا دكتور.
دكتوره صفاء, ايه راي حضرتك في اللي احنا قلناه؟ يعني احنا بنتكلم ومعانا كل الناس مصريين حبايبنا, فمش هنطول في الانجليش, خلينا كده فريندلي. يعني ايه راي حضرتك
دكتور عصام؟ حضرتك منورني ومشرفني وعلى راس من كل اسيوط وكل سعيد مصر الجمال. دكتور ياسر, حضرتك تسمح لي اتكلم يا فندم؟ دكتور ياسر اتكلم يا فندم, ولا حضرتك هتجاوب على حاجه؟
اوكي, ما فيش مشكله. في بس في سؤالين لسه دكتوره صفاء لو سمحت.
اتفضل, انا هتكلم.
في دكتور احمد ناصر بيسال على اللي هو البوست اوبراتيف بين مانجمنت ان بيشنت ويز مالتيبل ريسك فاكتورز. اوف كورس ات ديفرنت فروم بيشنت تو بيشنت, but now for all the anesthesiologists using multimodal analgesia, and you have to minimize the medication which have cardiovascular effect. It is your job according to the medication you have, and you are familiar with it. I am not going to tell you some protocol or something. You have to assist one patient, and it may be simple surgery. He needs simply just paracetamol or something like that. So the question from Dr. Maha Lotfi, it is a routine to ask for the HbA1, this glycosylated hemoglobin, long standing. If you are query about any poor control of blood sugar, you should check it, of course. Okay, so it is recommended in patient with, you are query about, not routine in all. If it is expensive, of course, you have to be restricted. If in your hospital you can do it as a part of routine, it is better to give it, because it will give you an idea about the cardiomyopathy in diabetic patient. If it is high for a long time, sure, this patient has a higher risk. Any questions more?
انا وان كويشن بس عايز اساله طبعا واكيد دكتور عصام برضه هيرد عليه برضه. احنا هنا في السعوديه بيبقى دايما المنطقه الشرقيه فيها السيكل سيل انيميا كتير، فهل دلوقتي ما بنواجهش المشكله دي في مصر بس بنواجهها بره انترناشونال السيكل سيل انيميا في المنطقه الشرقيه، فهل ده معناتها ان احنا كل بيشنت داخل نحاول ان احنا نديتكت السيكل سيل ولا نسيبها للفاميلي هيستوري تيكينج؟ ايه راي حضرتك دكتور عصام ودكتور ياسر؟
دكتور خالد، يعني طبعا سؤال حضرتك جيد جدا، بس اي ثينك ان في طبعا في السعوديه في انديميك ارياز معروفه في الساوث، فاي بيشنت بيجي فعلا عندنا في كينج خالد يونيفرسيتي هوسبيتال فروم ذا ساوث في الحتت اللي هي زي عسير والحتت اللي هي في الساوث كده، فعلا بيتعمل لهم سيرفي وبيعمل لهم بلاد تيست علشان السيكل سيل انيميا لانها انديميك في المنطقه دي. وفي عائلات بالاسم طبعا حضرتك عارف في عائلات بالاسم بيبقوا معروفين ان هم عندهم سيكلر، فبيتعمل لهم فعلا سيرفي، لكن نوت كومون في بالنسبه للمناطق الاخرى. ده بالنسبه اللي بيحصل عندنا في كينج خالد. بس يمكن في الشرقيه عند حضرتك
المنطقه الشرقيه كلها برضه منطقه الشرقيه الدمام والبحرين والحته دي كلها.
الشرقيه عند حضرتك يعني انسيدنس كبيره جدا يعني عندكم، فبيبقى اكتر بتتعمل وهو تيست بسيط يعني لما ياخد بلاد تيست مش هياخد مش نوت كوستلي يعني، لكن هيبقى طبعا هيفرق جدا بالمانجمنت للبيشنت يعني.
صحيح.
Electrophoresis. What do you mean, Dr. Nagy? Is echo should be routine investigation for preeclampsia? I think so, yeah. If, because preeclampsia has hypertensive heart disease, I think, and it is very simple to be done. Why not? And there is some issue. Some patient may have interstitial edema. This is around 20%. Interstitial edema, that's just increase lung water without clinical symptoms or signs of heart failure. So I think it should be done. I am not doing obstetrics since long time, but I think it should be done. What do you think, Dr. Safaa?
Really, it is not the one of the routine investigation of preeclampsia. Preeclampsia CBC is mandatory to evaluate hemoglobin level, platelet and the white blood cells. Number two is the liver function. Number three is prothrombin time and the concentration. This is the routine investigation done for this patient and also with the pregnancy after the 20th week. بعد الأسبوع العشرين ده الروتين اللي هو بيتعمل، لكن الحقيقة الإيكو مش هيتعمل إلا لو في حاجة أرجنت بتقول إن أنا عندي إيمينانت إكلامسيا in the form of right hypochondrial pain, blurring of vision, unrelieved headache. كل الحاجات دي اللي تقول إن أنا I'm going to have convulsion or severe إكلامسيا. Now I can do إيكو to يعني optimize the heart condition. Like, not really a routine one.
Okay.
Only every day I have a case. Yeah. I don't do it before. Unless it's going to be eclamptic patient and not pre-eclamptic patient.
There is some questions from Dr. Waleed. When it is mandatory to consult cardiologist and or post-operative ICU request, also the echo request if not requested by the cardiologist. I'm not understanding well, but of course, if you have any signs or symptoms suggestive of any myocardial injury or heart failure, you should, of course, involve the cardiologist in the management of the patient. And a patient with moderate to severe aortic stenosis undergoing TURB, recommended anesthetic plan. Actually, it is a little bit difficult. It depends on the severity of aortic stenosis. If it is so severe and causing significant signs and symptoms of low cardiac output, the patient has aortic valve replacement first. If it is compensated, and usually they recommend general, not spinal anesthesia, because the reduction in the systemic vascular resistance may be difficult in aortic stenosis. So I think it is general anesthesia will be a good choice. What do you think, Safaa, Khaled, Saab?
Of course, aortic stenosis. Aortic stenosis means general anaesthesia. And no way. I suppose that.
Dr. Yasser, if you excuse me, if you allow me to comment, I'm not underestimating the role of the cardiologist or our colleagues because they are scientists. We appreciate their job, but really, they sometimes and or most of the times they don't know what is going on in the theater.
Yes, yes.
They are considering our rules in anaesthesia and in surgery. They don't know what is the stress we are facing and the patient is facing with the operation, with the surgery, and with the anaesthesia and exposure of anaesthesia.
Yes,
most of the time they underestimate this stress and they recommend or consult, or when we are sending for the fitness for the cardiologist, they are dealing with the patient as medical case, not surgical case. It will be exposed to anaesthesia and surgery. That's why I advise myself and my colleagues to be judicious in dealing with cardiac patient, and they know their rules as anaesthetists, what are they going to do in the theater away from the recommendation of the cardiologist. For example, one day I saw the fitness return back to us saying these sentences, and what is going on? They said, give the patient oxygen, avoid dehydration or hydration, and give good analgesia. This is the view of our cardiologists. I don't underestimate their role, but we should deal with the patient as anesthesiologists.
Dr. Yasser, بعد إذن حضرتك.
دكتور ياسر، بعد إذن حضرتك. دكتور ياسر. لا بس في سؤال أخير. حاضر. دكتورة سهيلة صبري، what is the extent we can benefit from cardiometry? I think Khaled have more experience than me for this.
يعني cardiometry is available. طبعاً إحنا بنستخدمه في معهد الكبد كتير جداً. وبدا هنا يدخل في منطقة الخليج برضو. It is a non-invasive technique بيعتمد على ECG electrodes. تم تجربته internationally تبع institute اسمه NICE Institute. وتم معادلته بالسوانجانز. صحيح هو والtransesophageal doppler مش بيوصلوا للaccuracy العالية جدا مع زي سوانجانز. لكن طبعا
حاجة عند الدكتور خالد مش عندنا احنا.
In assessing your patient's intraoperative, so it is something that you can use. وفي a lot of research have been done. Okay. فضلي دكتورة.
كنت أبى كومنت بس على رأي الدكتور عصام على إزاي إن الكارديولوجيست فعلا أنا بسمي برضو الكارديولوجيست من الناس اللي هم عايشين في الاير كونديشن، فدول ما ينفعش يقول لي، هو ما بيقوليش الفيتنس بتاع البيشنت فور جنرال أو ريجنال، هو بيأسس البيشنت كونديشن بري أوبراتيفلي أند أي ويل ميك ماي ديسيجن at a suitable time for the patient and a suitable time for his medical condition. This is my opinion. Dr. Assam. Hiba, اقفلي يا هبة. هبة اقفلي. دكتور عصام، انا رايي طبعا مع حضرتك ان الكارديولوجيست ده من ضمن زي ما احنا قلنا كده الناس اللي قاعدين في الاير كونديشن، احنا اللي واقفين في العمليات، فهو يقول لي الحاجات اللي بتاع، لكن انا الفيتنس بتاع الاوبريشن او اختار جنرال او ريجنال، لا ده اتس نوت هيز جوب.
لا هو في ريسك ستراتيفيكيشن فور ذا انستيزي اند فور سيرجري، هم اواي فروم ذيس ريسك ستراتيفيكيشن، لان هو هي از ديلينج وذ ذا بيشنت از ميديكال كيس.
طبعا
طب. That's it يعني. طب. That's it. فإحنا we should consider our stratification.
قاعد في الاير كونديشن.
لا 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 we don't understand their job.
Oh no, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
لا لا جهان روماتولوجي.
لا معلش هو هكون موجود.
لا 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 لا.
دكتور
خالد. دكتور خالد.
دكتور محمد أحمد. دكتور محمد أحمد. Join us please. دكتور محمد
دكتور خالد ياسين في سؤال لو تكرمت في هل النون انفيزيف مونيتورينج از كونسيدر ا سبستيتيوت فور كيسز اوف هارت فيلير ذان ذا انفيزيف مونيتورينج اند ذا روت دايجنو اولسو روت تولز ناو از افيلابل ايفري وير وات دو يو ثينك دكتور خالد اي ثينك يو ار يوزينج
لا طبعا في الحالات بقى بتاعه الهارت فيلير واللي فيها الدرجات تفرق we should really use the pulmonary artery floating catheter particularly in ICU بس طبعا ما فيش مانع ان احنا برضو نستخدم ترانسوسفيجيال ايكو دوبلر ان احنا نشوف برضو وان دايجنوز في حاجات مش هيقدر سوان جنز يعملها زي مثلا لو في عندنا اير امبوليزم pulmonary
النت بيقطع شويه
في حاجه مهمه جدا ال invasive tools زي البالس بريشر فاريشن بتساعد كتير جدا لكن طبعا لازم نتذكر في وجود كل التطور اللي بيحدث ده ان الجولد ستاندرد هو البالمونري ارتري فلوتنج كاثيترز المسمى سوان جانز
دكتور محمد ابراهيم اتفضل يا فندم منور الدنيا دكتور محمد ابراهيم اتفضل دكتور محمد احمد دكتور محمد احمد اتفضل مساء الخير ازاي حضرتك
منور الدنيا مساء النور ما شاء الله ميتنج جميل ويعني فيري جود ستارت وربنا يبارك في المنوفية أناسيزيا كلاب ويجعله في ميزان حضرتك والقائمين عليه محاضرة الدكتور ياسر جميلة وممتعة كالعادة دكتور ياسر كان النايب سينيور بتاعي في الإسكندرية وأنا تشرفت بالعمل معاه من أحسن الشخصيات اللي الواحد ممكن يتعامل معها على المستوى الإنساني والمهني محاضرة جميلة جدا الله يخليك وفيها حاجات مهمة جدا ال مايكارديال انجري افتر نون كاردياك سيرجري نيو ايمرجن كونسبت ان ذا مانجمنت اوف كاردياك بيشنت فور نون كاردياك سيرجري البيست guidelines which deal with the myocardial injury after non-cardiac surgery هي guidelines بتاعت Canadian Society of Cardiology for management of cardiac patient for non-cardiac surgery and the routine is to do ECG in the recovery or post anesthesia care unit and troponin daily post-operatively in certain indications, it will be done for 48 to 72 hours. Patients who has ischemic changes in the ECG or who has elevated the troponin without full picture of myocardial infarction are diagnosed as having this myocardial injury after non-cardiac surgery. And it was found that the post-operative morbidity and mortality is higher for the first 2 years after surgery in these patients. And they are treating these patients with statins and one of the new oral anticoagulant drugs to decrease the incidence or the increased mortality and morbidity after the myocardial injury after non-cardiac surgery. الحاجة الثانية when we are consulting cardiologists our aim is to diagnose the cardiac problem that the patient is having and also to optimize the cardiac function before the surgery. Assessment of the risk for cardiac risk or general risk for the patient's cardiac patient undergoing non-cardiac surgery, we can follow any of the risk tools like the revised cardiac risk index This is specific for cardiac major cardiac events, adverse cardiac events after non-cardiac surgery. And also we can assess the risk in general because we do not assess the risk for developing cardiac complications only. We are assessing the risk as total risk that the patient may face when he will go for this non-cardiac surgery. And the best two risk scoring techniques that we have now and applied widely are the American College of Surgeons cardiac surgical risk calculator. But unfortunately, this surgical risk calculator is only used nationally. So when we are assessing the patient risk according to the surgical risk calculator, we are assuming that the patient will do his operation in USA. The more internationally applied risk stratification for patient undergoing surgery is a POSM risk and PPOSM. This is a simple risk. You can find it on the web page of the POSM or PPOSM risk calculator. It calculates the risk for the specific patient according to the data that you will enter. So I advise everyone who will go for anesthetizing a major case or a high risk patient to use the POSM or the PPOSM risk calculator to assess the risk. And this will help us in getting the consent from the patient because the patient right is to know the risk associated with the surgery. Regarding the beta blockers, preoperative beta blockers, the evidence now is the good evidence is with continuing the beta blocker if the patient is maintained on the beta blocker. We will continue the beta blocker until the day before surgery. If the patient is in need for beta blocker before surgery, we have to start the beta blocker earlier, not 1 or 2 days before the surgery. We have to start it at least 1 week before surgery to allow time to manipulate the dose according to the response. But starting the beta blocker 1 or 2 days before surgery, there is a good evidence against this strategy. Nothing more I can comment on. Thank you, Dr. Yasser, for this very great lecture. Thank you, Dr. Safaa, for allowing us to enjoy this meeting. And inshallah, it will be one of the very successful.
I'm waiting meetings. Everyone from my great scientific committee to deliver us like that lecture. Really, أنا في الأول يمكن مش عارفة حضرتك كنت معنا ولا إيه قلت لهم دي أجواء ليلة العيد الحقيقة وإن اليوم مبهج جدا وورم جدا 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 وكل حاجة حلوة فيه الحمد لله وكل حاجة تأدت على أكمل وجه يعني حاجة جميلة الحقيقة وأنا مستنية كل البروفيسورز اللي على الساينتيفيك كوميتي إن كل حد بعد إذنك ويديني معاد نعمل يوم زي جميل زي ده إن شاء الله.
أنا بس عندي كومنت لو سمحت يا دكتورة صفاء.
اتفضل يا فندم.
لو تكرمتي الدكتور فضل. خالد ياسين والدكتور ياسر زغلول كل ما بشوفهم أنا ببقى غيران جدا منهم لسبب واحد فقط أنا ما أعرفش الناس دي بتعمل إيه في شكلها والناس دي بتصغر إزاي.
رأسما أنا هبعت لحضرتك على الواتساب هم بيعملوا إيه.
الناس دي بتحلو إزاي والناس دي بتاكل إيه ولا هي مسألة الفلوس الكتيرة اللي معاهم. يعني يقولوا لنا السبب بس في النهاية.
إن شاء الله أنا السبب هبقى معاكم
في كيس ديسكشن كده يعني.
إن شاء الله.
يقول لنا بس الدكتور ياسر والدكتور خالد إن شاء الله. ربنا يديهم الصحة والعافية.
ياسر أنت عارف ياسر أنا ما أعرفش.
كده خلاص دكتور ياسر في أسئلة تانية قدام حضرتك دكتور ياسر.
أنا خلاص شكرا جزيلا الله يكرمك، شكرا جزيلا جدا، وأنا مبسوط إن أنا أكون أول واحد أقول محاضرة في المنوفية أنستيزيا كلاب، وإن شاء الله يكون لقاء علمي ممتع ويستفيد منه الجميع، الكبار قبل الصغار إن شاء الله بإذن الله.
أكيد. ودعوتنا لكل الشباب إنهم يستفيدوا من ويواظبوا، ريت يبقى الميتنج ده مثلا مرة في الشهر يكون منتظم، بحيث إنهم يستفيدوا بيه، بالذات طلبة الداخلين الدكتوراه والماجستير، هم بيعوزوا فعلا لقاءات علمية زي كده، ويتقابلوا مع الناس overseas ويسمعوا وجهات النظر. نصيحتي لهم دايما اقروا المجلات العلمية وشوفوا الريفيو articles والإديتورز مكتوب فيها ايه، وخش وتابعوا الأحدث اللي موجود على الباب ميد، ما تبقوش restricted للكتب والtext books فقط، احضروا webinars على قد ما تقدروا. في النهاية مهنة التخدير ما هيش كتب، هي experience that you build up over the years. فلما بتدخل الامتحان بتبقى already خلاص انت جاي بتعمل interview، مش لسه داخل تمتحن، انت شفت الحاجات دي. ونصيحة برضو مهمة جدا، اي حاجة ايدك بتمسكها حاول انك انت تفهمها كويس، يعني لو بتتكلم على pulse oximeter او بتتكلم على ECG او بتتكلم على blood gases او بتنيم حالة cardiac، فحاول انك تفهمها كويس جدا. اخر حاجه ودي برضو نصيحه مهمه جدا، اللي شايف ان في حاجه ناقصه عنده في التريننج، مثلا لو كاردياك نيورو اي سي يو، هي شود جو فور ذس، يعني شوف فين السنتر بيعمل الكلام ده ويلتحق بيه يوم يومين، بحيث يقدر انه يكيب هيم سيلف ابديت. وبالتوفيق لكل الزملاء.
السبت الجاي ان شاء الله دكتوره صفاء، يعني مش اللي هو ده، مش بكره اللي بعده، لو انتوا جاهزين انا جاهز لل، يعني هيكون كيس ديسكشن في الثوراسيك انستيزيا، واتمنى ان الاخوه اللي معانا، يعني انا احب يكون في انتر اكشن كده لما هتكلم يردوا عليا بس. وجزاك الله خير.
يعني ختاما اولا نرجع لفضل الله سبحانه وتعالى انه من علينا بناس العلماء الأفاضل المحترمين اللي مدوا إيديهم بكل حب وود وعطاء، ويعني أنا متشكرة جدا جدا لحضراتكم، وحضراتكم جميعا على رأسي من فوق، متشكرة جدا جدا لحضراتكم،
ادتوني
وقتكم وجهدكم وكتر خيركم. ثانيا إن شاء الله يوم السبت طبعا إحنا نستنى حضرتك يا دكتور عصام، طبعا إحنا ريدي إن شاء الله. ثالثا إن شاء الله قدام حضراتكم بوعدكم إن كل البروميسنج زي ما الدكتور ياسر قال لي لازم تسميهم البروميسنج أنافيسيولوجيست لازم يتجاوبوا زي ما أنتم شايفين، فمن فضلكم كل البروفيسور بتوعنا بيوجهونا هو إن احنا نتكلم وين رياكت، وده أنا كنت طلبته حتى من الدكتور خالد ياسين، يبقى فيه نوع من الرياكشن من الناس، لحتى لما بنحط بيبر أو بنحط سؤال من فضلكم يبقى فيه نوع من التجاوب، يبقى كده أنا مش عارفة أنتم خايفين ليه، احنا مش قاعدين في لجنة امتحان، احنا بين رياكت، احنا معاكم وبنقرا معاكم وبن ابجريد اور سيلفز معاكم، انا بقول على نفسي انا اي ابجريد ماي سيلف معاكم، فارجوكم يبقى في نوع من الرياكشن، نوع من الود، احنا مش قاعدين في لجنة الامتحان، احنا مع ناس بروفيسور عظام جدا لا ينقصهم شيء وبيدوا عندهم بكل انواع العطاء، وفي نفس الوقت يعني ما فيش بعد كده يعني، فأرجوكوا يبقى في نوع من التفاعل، نوع من الحضور، كل الحاجات دي تبقى موجودة. طبعا أنا متشكرة لأستاذ الدكتور ياسر زغلول على رأسي من فوق، شكرا لحضرتك دكتور عصام بي مناع، دكتور خالد بي ياسين، دكتور محمد إبراهيم، وكل الأتندي اللي أنا ما عرفتش أشوفهم عشان خايفة مدي إيدي على الكمبيوتر من الدكتور ياسر، وأقسم بالله فمش عارفة مدي إيدي أعرف مين اللي موجود، فسامحوني كلكم وحضراتكم جميعا نورتوني، وتصبحوا على خير.
الله يسمع السلام.
الله يسمع السلام.